if you have questions, you can ask them from yesterday. We can ask them now. And after this, before we really continue, I want to have a short demonstration in LabVIEW. And okay, I can hand it over to Carmen Kozer and for Peter Petkoff for you to have it. But you have to be able to, on your laptop or some machine to run LabVIEW. And the experts, as you can see, this is an old version. And this old version is on this old laptop. It's not valid anymore. And I'm not paying for it anymore, so it's not quite legal what I'm doing. But it's still working. I don't want to keep it working. Demonstration.
So that's a software for fast Fourier transform.
It is a computer aided design platform. It's just a tool for demonstration. Normally it's used for data logging. The most frequent tools that we use at Astrons and also at universities is MATLAB. And at Astrons, all the pictures I made in the, which you can clearly recognize them, they're from generated by MATLAB. They're just simulations. But MATLAB has two disadvantages. Extremely expensive. And if you're a student, I advise you to buy it's a student's version, so at least you can keep confident with the jargon, with the writings. And if you work in a company, it's no problem. The company pays for it. I think they pay $100,000 a year for all this. Yeah, this is gigantic. They're blackmailers. They're squeezing you out. But I think there is a group of intelligent engineers or so, mathematicians, they have an alternative. It's called Octave. And Octave is close to MATLAB. It follows MATLAB, but it's free. I've never tried it. It's okay. There are clever students who are able to install Octave. And you can use MATLAB code and do the same simulations and stuff. And by the way, there are other tools beside MATLAB. There is MATCAD, which is used by scientists and physicians. There is Mathematica. There are several tools. Maple, you have a whole list of CAD tools by which you can do simulations. The one MATCAD is especially very good in doing integrals and really mathematical formulas. MATLAB is really based on matrix multiplication. That's the basis. And MATLAB is, since 10 years or so, they bought out Simulink. And Simulink is the one that does block schematics, and simulations on base of block schematics. And they're now integrating people of MATLAB integrating Simulink in their tool so that you can use both together. There's another movement. Okay, then I go back here. I put here, you can read VHDL.
Yes.
You probably know.
Yes, I use it.
You use it?
Yes.
Okay. Now, this originates from American defense industry from the end 1980s.
Yes.
And American companies always mistrusted towards the government, so it never really got hold. But in the 1990s, it became not popular. But among specialists, like me, it became popular. In the beginning of the 90s, I used it when it was still in its beginning. It was the version of 87. And I used it for describing the code the chip I was making, only describing, because synthesis was not possible at that time. And I went to Munich at that time, and there were people from England, and they had a synthesizer, a beta release, and I was used as guinea pig. So I could use the synthesis for free, and they work you with what came out. It worked, there were some flaws, and after this, it was the synthesis tools of VHDL was full grown. What does VHDL do? VLSI, high level description language. It is VLSI, very large scale integration. It is the CMOS technology which I described. And the high level description you described in a kind of, it's not a programming language, but in a type of language you describe these type of circuits in script. And if you ask someone from software who reads VHDL code, oh, so it's programming. No. Programming is something quite different than using VHDL. VHDL is a hardware description language. It's not software. You describe hardware, and the tools that have been developed, there is a free platform now. I think they have now VHDL 2000 or 2008, keep on development. And so it's very, very, it's not like some programming language. They appear and then they disappear again after 10 years because their popularity is lost. VHDL is quite a stable language which you can describe the hardware. And there are companies who are offering tools so that you can, by one push at the button, the script that you have is turned into a circuit. That's called synthesis. That's the ultimate goal of any designer. You put something VHDL, push the button, and circuit is there. For simple circuits, yes. But for complicated circuits, forget it. Because then you are dependent on customers' requirements, and you cannot put that in VHDL. You need to do other things. And also, using VHDL, you have to have a hardware background to use it properly. If you're a programmer and you start to do it, you end up with nothing, you end up with rubbish. So, keep in mind, the term VHDL is closely connected. So it's an open standard, unlike MATLAB. MATLAB, yeah, they squeeze you out. It's an open standard. You can use it everywhere, the synthesizers. Synthesizers, however, are sold by companies. One of the big companies who, like some black hole in the universe, is swallowed up all its competitors is Mentor Graphics. Mentor Graphics is not a sole survivor, there are some few. Maybe you know the other ones, I don't know. Mentor Graphics is a big company like Rockefeller, who bought out all its competitors and offers complete platforms to do all the designs, the hardware designs. It has simulators, it has the synthesis, it has, you can do the specifications, you can do lots of things. And also, you pay lots of money for it, yeah. That's, of course, that's their business. Now, enough of this. Maybe if I have time left, I can tell you something about structured and top-down design. Okay, the directives, I learned at Ericsson, but this is outside scope. It continues on this. First, I show you what I have here. Is I can here choose, I have here a whole list of frequencies. This is my fundamental frequency.
that's here F0, I have 2 F0, 3 F0. Here I have all the multiples of the fundamental frequency. I can choose that here, play around with it. I can choose the amplitude and the phase of each component. That's what, in fact, what the Fourier series does. We have a whole series of frequencies, multiples of the fundamental frequency. The periodic signal is defined by amplitude and phase of the of all these components at these specific lines. What I will do, this is a synthesis part, and there are some extras to show you around how vulnerable it is. I shall try to make an approximation of a square wave, block wave. And like as many of you know, a block wave has only the odd valued frequencies. So I will choose first I choose some frequency, and now I I choose a large number 60. I do this on purpose because all these things work with integer numbers.
Yeah.
It's a bit shaky model. I think some students can do better than I do making these models. And there was put a reward for improving this model so it could be exempted from exams. Students did it. I put 60 and yeah. Okay. Now here we have a sine wave with a real harmonic with this frequency and some amplitude 60. And I can, for example, I can play around with the, as you see, frequency change. And what you also see is you have here a single spectral line. You see this move around for the higher frequencies to it. Lower frequencies to there. Now I'm going to add the second one, and I only take the odd ones, and I take this one and I take 20. 60 divided by 3. Yeah? If I keep this as a reference, then this will be 1/3, this will be 1/5, this will be 1/7. 60 divided by 7 is not an interesting number, it's not an interesting number, but. Okay, here's my second spectral line. This is one is this reference point. This is 3 times the reference point, the reference frequency. And you see here something that starts to look like a square wave, which, this is not, of course, not the case yet. But, he's dead. I put a third one. 1/3, 1/5. And I shall put the frequency somewhat lower. So that this is so effect. So that's better. You see it's still oscillating and the Gibbs effect will be to the edges of the wave. I shall try another one. That's 60 divided by 7. I put 9. It will not be accurate, but the idea will be clear. 1, 2, 3, 4 spectral lines, and it starts to resemble more and more like a fundamental wave. Rectangular square wave. I'm one more to go, 9, and then I have to expand the model. 60 divided by 9 is 3. Something like this. Yeah. And I put here 3. And yeah, okay, the numbers here are not, this should be 60 divided by 7, this should be 60 divided by 9, and the more frequencies I add, the better it resembles a square wave, and the frequencies I add will be parts of a harmonic sequence, 1, 1/3, 1/5, 1/7, 1/9, and so on. Until infinity, eh? And then you're still left with Gibbs phenomenon. It never disappears. This is how, with Fourier series, you can synthesize any harmonic wave that you want. I can also try triangular waves. I can do that, and then it works. You have been 1 squared, 1/3 squared. 1/5 squared, 1/7 squared, then it is squared. During this morning, it will be clear why that is, because a rectangular wave and a triangular wave are related by means of differentiation or integration. If you have a triangular wave and you take the derivative of it, you have to get a square wave. And in the frequency domain, it means times differentiation. Integration means dividing by g omega. And okay, not los. Okay. Get about the last sentences, then it will be squared, inverse squared. For triangle, we can try maybe attempt to do this. Why not? We just square everything. In computations, everything is possible. We square this. Have my sine wave back, of course. The others are drowned. I want to push this back. And this is 400. And this will be 144, which is still exact. And 9 squared. It's still not a triangular wave.
But funny, it was more triangular before the 9 squared and the 3 squared. So it was more like a triangle.
Yeah.
So, when it was at the third step, it appeared more triangular shape.
What I'm doing now is I'm only filling in the amplitude.
Yes.
But that's another important thing. I have to play around with the phases as well. And I can do this by shifting this. And then. This one I leave. And this one, if you shift it for 180 degrees, I just put a minus sign. So it is plus, minus, plus, minus, plus. Looks very good. Looks yes. Quite good. Yeah? Ah. So a short now, what happens if a short cycle? What happens if the they are not related, they are not multiples. And what I've done now, this is the here's the fundamental frequency, three times the fundamental frequency, five times, seven times. What if to every frequency I add a small proportion, so not in the, with the same ratio, a small, everyone, to every frequency I add the same small proportion. You see what I, what happens? You're cold. Okay. A very small proportion. Now what you see, the whole building collapses. This is not three times this fundamental frequency anymore. This is not five times. But this is five times plus a small amount. And this is three times plus the same small amount. No multiple connections anymore. And no Fourier series anymore. But, okay, yeah, this is actually put it back. Or I can put it even. Yeah, if I put too large, then I...
it reverts to the original harmonic, yes.
I put it back in... yeah, okay, we watch now the time domain, but also watch here at the, what in the frequency domain what happens. Put the spectral lines further apart. What you now demonstrate already, if you compress the time domain, you expand the frequency domain. This is one of the fundamental properties we shall see mathematically. But here you see it already demonstrated. Yeah, here you see something of the phase, which is important, but okay, for this demo I ignore it. I shall close the demonstration. It's always tricky. Close. Come on. Maybe if it's okay, it goes quite well. I can try another one. And to demonstrate the idea behind orthogonality, because what yesterday it was quite an abstract story for purely for mathematicians, but you can demonstrate it here as well. I do the same thing. I run model. I have some fundamental frequency. I have here some amplitude. Okay, 6 feet in. And what I here have is a square wave. Yeah. Okay. What I can do here is for several multiples of the fundamental frequency create square waves. But now pay attention especially to the spectrum. What I wish a linear combination of square waves. Build, synthesize a harmonic signal here. And I will not look focus here, I will focus here. The first thing I have to do is to suppress this one. I focus on suppressing the suppress this one. And what I do, I remember from previous demonstration that this was 20. I put that 20 but with a minus sign. So I take 20 and I put, or I can see a phase shift of 80 degrees, I put a minus sign. And you see here, okay, I suppress. Okay, this I repeat this for the five times the fundamental frequency. And I remember that I had here, I had 12. And again, I put a minus sign, so I put 180 degrees. It's not a new at the sign, not a sine wave yet. Okay, I just continue. This was 60 divided by 7 plus 9, I put here. And
I hope at least that you see the mechanism that I use. I want to suppress all, my goal is to suppress all these spectral lines here, so that only this one is left, and when this one is left, I have a sine wave. This is not a sine wave yet. I can do another, and
hopefully it starts to resemble better and better. And do a phase shift again.
Now, okay, this is a bit fine-tuning. I need many more frequencies, but if I add up enough, a sufficient number of square waves, I can end up with a harmonic signal. So just the other way around. The previous demonstration, I used a set of harmonic waves to create a square wave. Now I use a set of square waves to make a harmonic wave. That's also possible. And this is because the set of signals here is a set of orthogonal signals. And mathematically it means that you take of each pair of signals, you take the inner product, and if the inner product is either 1 or 0, it means that they're perpendicular, then the inner product is 0, or they coincide, and then the inner product is 1. And in this case, I have 9 of such components, and represent the units on the axis of a 9-dimensional space. Let me think in 3 dimensions. Some mathematicians think in 3 dimensions. Now, this is all, okay, I wanted to demonstrate for you today. So, the how to build a harmonic, or how to build a periodic signal with harmonics. And the other way around is also possible with a set of square waves, or a set of triangular waves, a set of any harmonic, you can build harmonic functions again. And now we continue. Switch this off. Oh yeah, another big trick. Signature.
still works. Okay. Quickly walk through again.
To recapitulate quickly, we started with the relationship, how you can represent complex harmonic signals with phasors, by putting them to a standstill, like a stroboscope. You don't rotate with the fundamental frequency, you put them to a standstill. Then, okay, some application in the electrical network. Some of the phasors with the multiple frequencies, they all rotate with multiple speeds. I forgot to mention why we have a two-sided spectrum. So it means you can have frequencies of 50 hertz, but what does a frequency of minus 50 hertz mean? And this depends on the rotation of the phasor. Phase of 50 hertz plus 50 hertz rotates counterclockwise, and the phasor of minus 50 hertz rotates clockwise. And if you have complex harmonics, a complex harmonic rotating counterclockwise, and another complex harmonic with the same amplitude and rotating with minus 50 hertz, if you add them up, then you end up with a real signal. Right? But then you have the physical signal again. That is the trick.
Could we go through it?
I expect that. You probably have the files. Come on.
Sorry.
You have the PDF files?
Yes.
Okay, so you all have the materials. If you miss something there, please note, because sometimes there are mistakes here, and some I'm aware of, so I can put them out. Okay, this is the part of the orthogonal base. So you can reread everything. It's all there. Okay, the representation. We don't use this. This is the representation. Huh? Complex exponential form. This one. These are my signals. And this is how I decompose them. These writings. This will reappear, Gibbs phenomenon I showed you, and then I skip this because it will return later on. What I put here is, I can present the mathematics. You can reread them. It's standard mathematics, it's computing integrals, but this gives you insight. Yeah, it only learns you how to do accurate computation. Calculations. This will give you insight. The pictures, they show you what is going on. Still, there's a lot of formulas here. Interest, this is an interesting one. This is a harmonic wave. This is a cosine. You can compute the Fourier series coefficients, and this will be the amplitudes of the spectral lines on this specific frequency, on this frequency. And if you have this form, for example, this is a nice exercise in goniometry. You can rewrite this with this rules of trigonometric rules. Cosine of a sum of arguments is the cosine time cosine plus sine of sine. And if you do that well, then you have here an amplitude and here an amplitude. It means that for real signals you also can have two components. If the cosine is one axis and the sine is one axis, you can make a decomposition there, and on the angle you can see you can estimate the phase of initial phase of
what kind of decomposition is depicted here? Well, I simply cannot read it.
Oh, this is IQ decomposition. That is in phase quadrature decomposition. A quadrature means that the cosine component is in phase, and the sine component, this is a real signal, eh? The sine component is the quadrature component. And this refers, as yeah, people from radio communication or have done single sideband modulation, they recognize this immediately. The quadrature component is something that happens when you do single sideband modulation in the wrong way. You are left with a quadrature component, which you want to get rid of. I'm not doing this, is far outside this lecture. By the way, this morning I went into the library, and if you look in bookcase 7B, behind, there are some books about signal processing. Also some English one and some good ones, also from Oppenheim and Schaefer. So there are some good books here, also from other writers. Okay, if you have time, you can take a look there, what they have. So, so you have some literature here as well. what I have here is, okay, the last one, we will come to that. This is, I've added here a cosine with three times. And if you have a system with the input a cosine and the output this signal with the multiple of the frequencies, then you have a system which is which generates a non-linear distortion. We will come to that in systems lecture, and this is not what what you normally want. Systems, non-linear systems, are very hard to describe. I think the only group that did an attempt to analyze non-linear systems and stability for non-linear systems were the Russians, and the name is indeed Chebyshev and Lyapunov, and there's a whole school of Popov and Pontryagin. There's a whole school of Russian mathematicians who did analysis of systems, control systems, in a mathematical way, much different than what I've been taught, because we learn it the American way, quick and dirty. You just make a feedback like Nyquist, and then see how things blow up or not. You can walk through them yourself. You see here a triangular pulse wave. You see here, you recognize here the inverse square, which I just demonstrated. The sawtooth wave is a special case. When we know the Fourier transform properties, there's a very elegant way, graphically, to compute these coefficients without many mathematics. But the result is that you have, this is an odd function always, you have two types. And you have the fundamental wave, you have the double frequency, the triple frequency, and the quadruple frequency. You have all the frequencies, not only the odd components. That's a special and indeed in a, also in an inverse harmonic. And the inverse harmonic refers that this is also related in some way to the square wave. You will see that later. This is an important one. We will see later on. It's also in the Fourier series. If you have a whole set, an infinite set of Dirac pulses, that is a periodic signal. What are the Fourier series coefficients corresponding to this periodic signal? It's a whole sequence of numbers of equal signs. So if this is your periodic signal, then the values here are the values of your Fourier coefficient. This is a very interesting function. Also of the Fourier transform, discuss this. Mathematicians will call this an eigenfunctie. Eigenfunctie. I think this is a German term, eigenfunctie. And the Fourier transform has two eigenfunctions. That's this one. It's invariant under for its when you do Fourier transform. And the other one we will show is the Gaussian pulse. Gaussian pulse gives Gaussian spectrum. So it's also invariant. So exactly two signals so invariant for the Fourier transform. Okay, this is why I skipped it. We can avoid applying the Fourier series, and we will avoid applying the Fourier series. This is the picture where we ended yesterday. We started with phasors, single frequency. We continued with a set of phasors here. And this is an even function, so you get a real signal. And this creates any particular periodic signal. In this case, we have a rectangular wave with duty cycle smaller than 50%, pulse is smaller than the period, than half the period. And if I keep the pulse width the same, fixed, and I extend the period, then I see in the frequency domain, I see compression taking on, and the envelope remains the same, because depends on the pulse. And if I do this more and more, I get more density. If I take the limit, I push the period to infinity, I have an aperiodic signal, transient signal, and have a continuous spectrum. This relationship is the Fourier transform. And the Fourier transform is described by this formula. Okay, we start with the new materials. And this formula looks horrible. But there are some ways to look through it. First, to start with, there are two forms. The form here above, maybe I should not have highlighted it. This is the form that electrical engineering is used. This form is also correct, but it is used by physicians in physics and in optics. It has to do whether you use omega in radians per second or f in hertz. If you are in your common work, you use hertz, then you use frequency. If you are used to use to apply Omega, then you use this form. This form has one disadvantage, it has also some advantages. But it has a disadvantage that I have this factor 2 pi. And maybe as you've noticed, I'm not a man of formulas, I'm a man of pictures. Can you read this, Cam?
Yeah.
I do not know. I always forget to make mistakes whether this 1 over 2 pi have to write here or here. I make mistakes. And I was a student once, and you are students now or have been students. So I guess you make the same mistakes. So I stick to this during the rest of the lectures. I stick to this representation. The S of t, the signal on time t0, specific time. I should do it the other way around. No, this is a signal st. And you can write this as a sum of complex harmonics, because this integral is an abstract sum, and this is the amplitude of this specific harmonic for this f, this specific, on the time t0. So you still recognize here the sum of phasors, but in a very abstract way. Yeah? And this is the this we call, in fact, the inverse transform. This is the formula, this is the forward version of the Fourier transform. So normally you start with this. You have a signal, you put this in this formula, do the computations, and your spectrum, and it yields your spectrum. That's how it works. Here I compute I can compute for one specific moment in time. The signal value from averaged over the spectrum, and here I do the reverse. I compute one specific frequency averaged over all signals. In time, here I do average over frequency. What's the unit? The unit here is volts. I put volts, just a signal, or amperes if you like. You have like magnetic fields, okay, take amperes. And here I have volts per hertz. This is a density measure. If I this is then okay, volt times seconds. Okay, to look through the through these formulas. Okay, the one I explained in previous slide. You can see as this description of computing a signal at a specific moment, and then average over all frequencies. So you go over all frequencies and you look where this phasor has a value. And because this is given in this formula, then you know how the distribution of phasors over your frequency domain is. This is the other way around. You compute a specific spectral line, specific frequency, and you take the average of the complete time, all time you have, to infinity, and look what values you have of the signal. This is a way how to look through it. We can make it one step more clear. I think the highlighting is not that clear. I should not have done this. If I put a zero here, it might become more clear. Then this one vanishes. What you then have is just the integral of the whole spectrum. You computed the area of your frequency spectrum. So the signal at time t is zero is simply the area of your spectrum. And that's a simple way to check if I've understood it. And the other way around, if you take the spectral line at 0 hertz, it is the area beneath your signal over the complete time range. And of course, if you divide the area by your duration, so area divided by time, then you get the average, and this is the DC level. The spectral line at 0 hertz is simply a representation of the DC level in your signal. This is very clear. These are some tricks to look through this formula. There's one thing before I forget. Here I have a minus sign and a forward there plus sign. And these are the phasors, the plus sign, and the forward transform is the minus sign. This is the only difference. And even I often make mistakes, or I neglect it. You will see during the presentation, I think sometimes I'm a bit sloppy, but the graphics, they work, they're very redundant. Formulas are not. If you make one mistake with a sign, then you're lost. You end up in rubbish. But with pictures you can graph. You can do many sloppy things and still have to maintain the right pictures. Okay, there's a reference example, and this is the only example that I will completely walk through with you. The mathematics. I will not do the mathematics because this is an important example, and my advice is, in fact, to learn this by head, to learn this by heart, to have this in your mind. This is one of the few computations that you have to know, and once you know this, you can do 90% of the constructions of frequency spectra, you can do with pictures. But this is one you can I do with mathematics, and later on I will also show you three methods by which you can do this by graphics, by using the properties. First, this one. This is, by the way, this is standard. This is in any book, you will find this. We have a rectangular pulse, and it has amplitude A for a certain duration tau, and for the rest of the time, before and after, is zero. Simple, it's just rectangular pulse. And there's not even a picture, but it's a rectangular pulse. This. Okay, here I have the formula for the forward transform. I take this signal, ST, I substitute here, and what I see here, okay, I put the A here, and I see the bounds of the boundaries of the integral change with them. I start at t0 and end with t tau, here's A. Now I start to do all my mathematics, all the tricks you have. And for power of E, it's easy. You bring that behind the D. At least that's how I learned it. And then you're left over with this constant factor, because T is the variable here, not F. T is but this constant factor. And you can check this by taking the derivative again, take this out, the chain rule, and then this gets e to the power of minus g times this factor. And then, okay, it is they cancel one another out, and then you end up with this again. So this is checked. So you have, you can compute this. The next step, evaluate the integral. I start at tau, this is this one, and I end up with t is zero. T is zero, this one becomes one. So this is one. These are the upper boundary and the lower boundary of the integral. So this is the solution, mathematically. Now I'm going to do some trick, and if you now keep in mind Euler's identity from complex numbers, I showed Euler in the forward direction, e to the power of gx is sine x plus g sine x, but if you write sine x into terms of e to the power gx, You probably
don't know.
This is very important still. E to the power of g phi, this is cosine phi plus g phi. And this means that cosine phi is half times e to the power of plus g phi plus e to the power of minus g phi. And sine phi is to g phi minus I think I do not know anything here, but this is important to remember why I do this here. And this is all. I apply this part of Euler's identity. And what I do here, I take here half the exponent here, and I take that outside this bracket. E to the power of minus g, g pi f t tau. And here I have minus e to the power of pi f. If I multiply them again, I end up with this. So this is correct. And the one I split up in minus and plus. So I have here two terms, e to the power of plus minus g pi f tau. Yeah, and what I hear, I recognize, I call this the joy of recognition always. You recognize this formula. And this factor is already there, so g2 is already there. So what I have here, and this is a sign. What I left over is this, and of course this this factor. This is the mathematical result, and I can evaluate it even further. When here I recognize something that is amplitude 1. It's always one. It's only dependent on the exponent here, and this is represents the phase, the angle. Now plus or minus 180 degrees. This is the angle. Here I have DC level, the amplitude, and this function. Yeah, this is a cursor function. It's called the sinc function. That's how you remember it. And this is, I'm always confused with the sign. This is together, is the amplitude of a specific spectral line. This function is crucial if you analyze this. Okay, here, summary of the... Wait a minute. Oh, it is, yeah, okay, it is in this, okay, you keep them right, I take some water, so, and okay, it's good also for your philosophy to think this over. Because the way I solve it here, I think all the other mathematics are similar, are the same. In fact, there's no difficulty, you have to be very accurate in your plus or minus signs and in applying the integral boundaries of they correct, you have to be very accurate. Okay, the mark down right is about the Fourier series. Okay. What we did is we have given rectangular pulse amplitudes A and duration tau, computed the spectrum. The spectrum looks like this. You recognize a sine wave, but this factor in the denominator makes this inverse proportion. Now, to write this picture is quite easy to remember. Always keep in mind the length. The duration of this pulse tau, and then you immediately know the first zero transition here. This is 0 hertz, and this is 1/tau hertz. If this is tau, here's 1/tau, and of course here's -1/tau. And all these other zeros, they are at regular distances, so it's easy if you know this, to sketch this by hand, just like that. And these, this is A of tau, this is about 1/3 of this value. No, 1/5. This is -1/3, plus 1/5, -1/7, and so on. Putting that right? Yes. Okay, this is the mathematical way to describe it, and this is how the formula looks like. Two important notices, and I remember how to look through these formulas of Fourier transform.
Question.
Yeah.
Why is the, I missed something, why is the amplitude at 0.8 tau? I didn't see a tau in the at the expression for the on the previous slide, if you go back one slide.
Previous slide.
Oh, there is? Okay, sorry, not
that. If I have a mistake, yeah, please know, because I did this computation 4 times before I got rid of all the mistakes and all the flaws. Well, if something is unclear, then please ask.
Okay.
Yeah, it's simple mathematics. This is okay. This is indeed an important slide to remember, and this is even more important. Like this way to picturize the Fourier transform is a I think is a very efficient way for you to remember. This, by the way, is if I am inspired by some, it is by my own university. We had a group of theoretical AM field, and they get it in this way. It's good, and a good book which picturizes creators from this is Ronald Bracewell from NASA, which I mentioned yesterday. He has, in his appendix, he has a whole list of Fourier transform with very good pictures, all for formulas. The formulas are horrible, which you write there. I make a mess out of it, but the pictures are very good. Okay, in this way I tend to make the pictures. So, this is tau, then this is 1 over tau. This is, okay, rule of thumb, to construct from a rectangular pulse very quickly the spectrum. You can say something more. If I compute the area of the signal, then from I told you that this is then the DC value as the S at the spectrum at frequency zero. I compute this. Now the spectrum at frequency zero is A times T. You just get rid of this e power and you compute this, and this is A times T. That's the area, the DC, and that's why at 0 hertz I put here A of T. So what I have here is the area of this pulse. The other way around, the value at time t, at moment 0, I have here amplitude A, then the area, if you do an integration from minus infinity to plus infinity of this function, it's very easy, it's A. You can do a whole day, a rainy day of computations with this, but with a simply glance of the eye, so this value here is simply the area under this function. Huh? You have plus and minus, okay, then cancel on this A. That is two important conclusions about this. And there are some more conclusions. They are less important. What I can say about this, this is an even function.
Yeah,
it's clear. This is symmetric. for x is 0. You can compute the zero crossings. We did it. This is at regular distances. There is, of course, here is confusion. What I use here is, most of the time is the European notation, the German or the Russian notation. And this, of course, is the Anglo-Saxon notation. They use something else, of course. They use sinc, and they define it as sine pi x divided by pi x. And then you get, of course, you get similar pictures with different horizontal axes. I avoid this. I don't want confusion. I take this as into account. But for completeness, I want to mention that in many American or English books, they use sinc x, and you have to realize, ah, this is something else. This is not exactly the same. Zero crossings. We can do more things. You can do a full analyze. You can take the derivative. And okay, if you do that, you end up here. You can compute then the maxima and minima of this red function, and you end up in an equation like this. It means that this function, you have to look at the intersection points with the sinc function here, with cosine, the blue one, cosine x, and okay, it's similar to solving this equation. Now, where you have intersection points, there you have the minima. You can see here is minimum, here is maximum. Here's a medium, here's a maximum, here's a medium. This fits. Yeah. Okay, here's the one doing with the sink. You can also take the integral and to compute the area. We did that, but there are some important functions that are related to this. What I said here that you can easily compute the area, and one of the conclusions is computing this integral of minus infinity plus infinity, and the solution is pi. We all have mathematics. I think there's a whole list of integrals, some standard integrals, and this is one of them. There is another one which we will encounter. It's called the error function, which is also related to this, also put in the table. And the book, where this is, there is a very good book. Again, probably you know this. It's by Milton. Abramovic. And Irene Stegen. And this is the handbook of mathematical functions. Why Dover publications. It's an American book. It is, in fact, it's, yeah, you could say world standard. Abramovic and Stegen. This is one of the Bibles of mathematics. You have all possible functions there. Also, it's put in tables or in graphics. Lagrange, Lagrange, all these polynomials, it's all there. I think I hardly know 55% of them. But if you, it is this thick. It's, and it is not expensive, by the way. It's just by sponsored by the government. It's not for profit. It is a very good book, but especially for mathematics, but also for technicians or engineers. Very good book. And of course it has a German predecessor, but it is forgotten. I want to mention them. Janck en Emde, for the Second World War. Janck en Emde did something similar, and this is making use of what Janck en Emde already did in the 1930s, giving a large book of mathematical functions, tables. And this, of course, was done before the computers, so there are lots of tables with logarithms, with all kinds of things you need for computations without computers. And nowadays, everything is in a computer. The computer, your hand calculator, easily computes tangent, sine, cosine. It uses one single algorithm for this, and this was developed in the 1959. It's called Poiret. It was invented just before the electronic revolution, before the transistors became became affordable in the beginning of the century. Poiret, you can look it up in the internet, is an algorithm that is called coordinate rotation. I see, I don't
And what they do, they form one simple mechanism by rotating a phasor. You can go to cosine and sine like this, and then switch to a tangent. And what they store in this in your calculator, they store a table of tangents, and they use it to compute very rapidly the cosine and the sine, and all kinds of and also kinds of exponentials. And this is how you compute it based on coordinate. I stop here because
no. Wolfram alpha.
Ah, I know. That is that's a big dispute about this. Wolfram is, I think, the promoter of Maple. I think this is one of these cut environments, which is very well documented, very good. But I think he is under attack also from. Soft fellow, because he is, I think, too much promoting himself. That is, but this is also a very good platform to find information. Wolfram, mathematics, yeah. Should I write it also there for people? But this is indeed based on. It's too like it's a maple. But, on the internet. Okay, yes. There are some more good books, very good handbooks. Okay, leave it out for the moment. I will come to this. Okay, you do the computations here, you do the integrals, and you get here an alpha formula, and this is the primitive function of the sinc function. If you take the derivative of this, then you get the sinc function back. But watch out for x is zero. For x is zero, you have to, if you do derivative, you have to apply the rule of the L'Hôpital for a limit, and then you get, I think, zero defined by zero. And if you have such a ratio, it's always dangerous because you will always get some finite value. It's the same as infinity times zero, then you should be mistrusty, and because then some finite value probably comes out. Okay, this is the SE function. This is typically from the table by Abraham and Stegen. This was also in Jank and Emdes. It's also already developed in the 1930s. Okay, the mathematical formulation, the key example, the rectangular pulse. Okay, now it's 11 o'clock. I think we make a break. Actually, the week. Yeah, we go break a cake, have coffee or something to drink.
Okay, let's drink some coffee.
Drink some coffee.